Well, I guess we begin the Hail Mary series with the Hail Mary, huh? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, we come to you through the intercession of your Holy Mother. Just ask you to bless what goes on here today. Bless our lives. Send Mary to inspire us, to teach us by her loving surrender to you. Mary, we look to you as our example and our mother and our intercessor. So be with us now. You are the spouse of the Spirit. And when you enter the room, so comes the Holy Spirit, which we ask to move among us and just inspire our thoughts and words this day. We pray, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I'm happy to be here with you to share some thoughts. And as Tim said, yes, I've been doing a lot of youth ministry in my life. Even in the summers, I will still go back and do some summer camps with the teenagers. Kind of found my niche in college ministry, though. It's nice. I've been doing it for a while now, and I enjoy it. I love being there when a young person gets it for the first time, where they start to understand that Jesus is real. Those moments are beautiful, and I've had quite a few over the years. Working with the little ones, the really little ones, you get to tell a lot of stories. And I find myself telling stories. I use the stories that Jesus told, of course, because, you know, especially the little ones, they hang on. You know, they tell me a story, Mom. Tell me a story, Dad. So one time I had these third graders in front of me, and I started to tell them the story of the prodigal son. Now, you got to think back to when you first heard that story, right? You didn't know how it was going to end. That was most of them. They were like wide-eyed and just kind of hanging on every word. So I told them the story, you know, the story about this younger son. He's rebellious, and he takes his dad's money, and he goes off and just spends it recklessly in a foreign land. And then he comes home, and he thinks he's going to be punished, but he comes home to a hero's welcome that includes slaughtering the fatted calf and having a big party. And then I told him about the older son who's watching all this, and he's just not happy. He's jealous of what treatment his brother's getting. So they're again, on the edge of their seat, they're listening, and you got to ask kids questions, right, to make sure they're with you. So then I kind of do a little recap, and I said, okay, who's paying attention now? Who was it that took the dad's money and went off and spent it in a foreign land? And a little 8-year-old girl raised her hand, and she said, the younger son. I said, yeah, that's right. Very good. And I said, and who was most upset when the younger son came back? And a boy raised his hand, and he said, the fatted calf. Which I loved. Great answer. Truthful answer, right? I mean, that parable could be entitled Very Bad Day for the Fatted Calf, right? I loved it. The prodigal son story, I use it all the time, especially with the youth, but it's such a good go-to parable. And it's a story of mercy, right? It reveals an important element, even of human suffering. If you think about it, there's so many lessons in that story, but one of them that touches on human suffering is that a lot of what we suffer in life is the result of our bad choices. We just have to admit that. Sometimes, you know, life gives us a raw deal, or another person does something that hurts us, but there are a lot of bad choices we make that we live and we see play out in our lives, even as we age and get older. And the younger son made the choice to leave the safety of his father's house to seek fulfillment in the pleasures of the world. And that's a choice that's going to lead to spiritual and sometimes even physical desolation that he experienced. He comes to a journey of self-knowledge in that leaving the house and coming back. And what I wanted to share with you this day is, again, St. Bonaventure. St. Bonaventure wrote a letter to the poor Clare sisters in 1260, and it's pretty much 8 steps of holiness. And I took that letter and I did 5 reflections on each of the 8 steps, so you have 40 meditations. So that's what my book is in the back of the room. Feel free to take one if you're interested. It's 40 stories, 40 reflections that try to unpack what Bonaventure presents as the steps towards perfect love or holiness. And the first one he presents is self-knowledge. Self-knowledge. A lot of the saints have said that, you know, the way to get to knowledge of God is through knowledge of the self. And so in the first chapter of Bonaventure's letter to the poor Clare sisters, he's gonna stir them up and stir us up, if we read it, to consider the bad choices we've made in life. You know, what have we said yes to that was not of God, right? How did we end up in the pigsty, like the son in the story who finds himself throwing husks of slop to pigs, maybe knee-deep in mud? He's yearning to eat the garbage in front of him. How did he get there? You know, that's a long journey that gets him there. And St. Bonaventure, at the beginning of his letter, is going to encourage us to look at the mistakes we've made and own them, really, and see what have we done that has taken us from the Father's house, what intrigued us and we thought was going to give us ultimate fulfillment, but led to us being with the pigs, you know? And maybe in life we have moments of that. Maybe we go back and forth. Maybe we're hanging out in the Father's house for a while, and then we get a little bored, and we go take a walk somewhere, and we pursue something else that is not of God, and find ourselves miserable until we run back home. So the first stage that Bonaventure presents in this journey to love and journey to holiness is self-knowledge and courageously looking at our weaknesses and the mistakes we've made. Now that's going to lead us to stage number 2, and that stage is humility, right? If you start and take any time at all to look at your mistakes and your weaknesses and your sins, it's going to humble you. But humility is a good thing. And St. Bonaventure will say, humility is the root and the guardian of all the other virtues. They all flow out of humility. It was important for him. And so he writes about it, and he calls the poor Clare sisters to humble themselves or to accept even the humiliations that life might throw their way, you know? And as I think of my own journey and trying to follow the Lord, I have been humbled many, 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 many times, just in thinking I was better than I was or falling flat on my face. I know even just physically, sports have humbled me throughout the years. When I was in college myself, I was on a flag football team, and I was on defense, and the guy was getting ahead of me, and he had the ball, and I ran, and I dove for his flag, and I missed, and I landed on my wrist, and I snapped my wrist, you know, right away. A few years later, I was playing basketball, and I had an open layup, and I was going to the hoop, and I heard a pop like that, and it was my Achilles tendon. Bang, I went down. Some years after that, I could go on and on. I was playing softball. You think softball, that's not, no one's going to get hurt in softball, right? Safe sport. But I was catching. I was behind the plate, and there was a guy on second, a big guy. It looked like he was recently released from prison, I think, if I remember correctly. He's on second base. The batter hits one into the outfield, and this guy from second rounds third, and he's coming into me, and the throw comes home, and I look up, and he lowered his shoulder and barreled into me, and I spun and did a complete 360, and I really saw stars and birdies, like they say you see. I saw them. And when the birdies faded, I thought, maybe I should be a priest. instead. You know, maybe that's a safer vocation than professional athlete. Nobody's ever torn a rotator cuff elevating a chalice. You know, it's safer, more my speed. But injuries can humble us. I remember having to depend on my brothers when I was on crutches to get my meals for me. And I didn't want to do that. I didn't want someone else to serve me like that. And that's a pride. That's a false humility. I guess I thought it was humility, but it's really pride. Because we all need one another. And sometimes being humbled can be something that's good for our souls. You know, and it reminds us of where our earthly bodies are heading, right? Sometimes we tend to glorify or glory in our own gifts, right? But our gifts are passing. And Bonaventure writes about that, and he's not afraid to say, today you're healthy, tomorrow you might be sick. You know, today you're wealthy, tomorrow you may have no money. Don't glory in anything of the earth that's temporary, but glory in the love of God. And so humility can do that for us. It can help us to focus on what's most important, which is God, his eternal gifts that don't pass. And instead of hiding behind the things we have, the gifts we've been given, he encourages us to be transparent. And Bonaventure picks up on St. Francis, who loved to poetically talk about water. And Francis called his brothers and sisters to be like water. He said, water is useful, humble, precious, and even chaste. Bonaventure picks up on that and says, water will always trickle down to the lowest places, and the greater the slope, the greater the descent. And so he parallels it to the role of humility in the spiritual life. Graces flow, he says, all the more powerfully to the one whose heart has been completely humbled. When we know our need for God for everything, suddenly we receive everything from God. So water trickles down to the lowest places as we are called through humility to take the lowest places. Water is pure and transparent. It's see-through, as he's calling us to be see-through, to be honest, to not put up a false image of who we are. That's what humility does. Humility allows us to let the walls down and just be who God made us to be. And let that be enough for us. Bonaventure will hold up St. Francis and St. Clair. They're the examples. He tells plenty of stories in his letter. I tell a few stories in my reflections on his letter about Francis and Clair. Who were contemporaries in 13th century Assisi who really got the concept of humility. They kept trying to serve, and the more authority they were given, the more they served others, like St. Clair, who washed the feet of her sisters. The church wanted her to be the abbess of the community, to be in charge of the community. She didn't want the title. She thought, titles aren't going to be good for me. They kind of forced her to take the title. She said, okay, I'll take it, but I'm going to be the one who washes the mattresses of the sick people and the feet of the women who come in from outdoors. Is that okay? I'm like, okay. She took a title and transformed it through humility. She was able to be obedient to the church by taking on the title, and also obedient to her heart by serving and making herself the lowliest in the monastery. So that's stage two of this eight-step process. So we have self-knowledge, which is going to lead to stage two, which is humility. And stage three follows from that, and that's poverty. Poverty. Of course, the poor Clare sisters, they have poor right in their name. You know, they were known for their poverty. They left the world and they surrendered their dowries and they lived a life of total dependence on God's providence. And they discovered in that the less you have to depend on, the more you see God active in your life. That's the big lie of the world. We want to accumulate more and more riches so we'll be secure. But what we're doing is putting up walls of gold, and then we can't see the Lord anymore. We block our own vision. And the early Franciscans, especially the ladies, the poor Clares, wanted nothing. They actually begged the Pope for the privilege of poverty so that no one could force them to own things. So much were they convinced that the less you have, the more you see the hand of God in your life. There's another beautiful story. Early on, St. Francis, first he heard this call from the Lord to rebuild my church. And there was the church of San Damiano, and it was falling apart. And the Lord spoke to him and said, rebuild the church. So when Francis was still living with his dad, who had plenty of money, he took some of his dad's money to buy some stones and some mortar to rebuild the church. He would later find out that God was calling him to even rebuild the whole universal church, but that's a separate story. But Francis went along, and he found this priest who went by the name of Sylvester, and he had a quarry, he had some rocks, and Francis bought some stones from him to rebuild this little chapel. Now, skip a few weeks ahead. Other young men in Assisi were intrigued by what Francis was doing, and two of them, Bernardo and Peter, were similar to Francis. They had wealth, but they were amazed that this man had left his wealth and was now living and wearing rags and taking care of people with leprosy, and they became intrigued and wanted to do what he did. So Francis took Bernardo and Peter, and he opened up the gospel and said, okay, we'll ask the Lord what to do. And in the gospel, he read to the passage, go and sell all that you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. So immediately they went out. Bernardo was the richest one. They took all his possessions and they sold them, and they had these bags of coins that they started to physically give to poor people. This happened one day in the piazza of Assisi. You can imagine the scene. There's these three men. They have pouches of coins, and they're tossing them to people. Well, people came from everywhere. What's going on? Free money. What's going on? They're throwing out coins. So people just started gathering. And this priest happens by, Sylvester, who had given Francis his stones earlier. And he sees, oh my goodness, Francis is rich. So he goes up to the three men and he says, Francis, you didn't pay me enough for the stones that you bought for me last week. And you know what Francis did? He said, okay, hold on. He reached into Bernardo's cloak, where he had the sack of coins, grabbed a big stack and dumped them in Sylvester's hands. He said, is that enough? Before Sylvester could answer, he said, oh, wait, he did it again. Got another stack of coins, put them in Sylvester's arms. Do you have payment enough now? And Sylvester's like, oh yeah, I do, thank you. And he ran off to his rectory. What happened next, though? Father Sylvester couldn't sleep. He woke up in the middle of the night. He's looking at these piles of coins on his dresser. And he said, what happened to me? What happened to me? I used to be like those guys. I used to be on fire for the Lord. And now look at me. I care so much about money and clinging on to the things of this world. How did I grow so cold? Those three young men, they put me to shame for their absolute love for the Lord. And the next day, Sylvester went out and he went back to the men and he asked Francis if he could join his band of poor brothers. And he became the first priest to join the Order of Friars Minor. Incredible story and witness of what poverty can really do, right? Think of all the ways Francis could have responded when Sylvester demanded more money. You know, he could have fought back. He could have said, you know, I that's not fair. And he probably wasn't fair. But instead, Francis doesn't approach someone who's greedy with greed, but he counters it with generosity. He gives him more than he can imagine. And that's a key to Francis's spirituality as well. And Bonaventure, conquer greed through generosity. When someone comes to you and they're prideful, face it with humility. Don't battle them. When someone's heart is at war, you don't go and fight them. You become a peacemaker. Practice the opposite virtue of the vice that is coming your way. And maybe conversion happens and salvation comes among us. Francis disarmed the prideful with humility, the greedy with generosity. He challenges the wealthy by witnessing to the joy that he found in poverty. And it was enough to make Sylvester have a conversion of heart and join the Friars Minor. So poverty is the third step on this road to perfect love and to holiness. And to move on to step number four, this is kind of a furthering of poverty, because step number four for Bonaventure is recollected silence. And silence really can be seen as a poverty of words, you know, refusing to just ramble on. Bonaventure talks about an idle word. He said, avoid idle words. Idle words are words that are spoken without necessity by the speaker and without usefulness to the listener. That's pretty good. That's pretty good, you know, guard to put over our mouths. Is what I'm about to say necessary for me to say and useful to the person in front of me? Because if not, zip it. It's pretty much his advice. Now, of course, he's talking to poor Clare nuns. They were super holy. They lived in silence as a big part of their day. But he highlights it as an important virtue on the way to love. And I have learned a lot about silence over the years because, you know, to make a religious vocation work, you got to spend a lot of time in silent prayer. It just doesn't work. I've been blessed to accompany the young men and the young women that are discerning priesthood or religious life. And one of the first things we always have to teach them is silence. Every generation's getting worse at it, I think. Everybody's plugged in, right? You know, so there's constant music or something, constant input that makes our brains crazy, I think. You know, you could really freak someone out if you said, could you sit there for 5 minutes of silence? To be like, without my phone? What do I do? Is anyone going to be there? What? You know, it's a strange time that we live in, and we have to relearn the value of recollected silence. So again, I often, in my ministry to the men that are discerning priesthood, we would take them on a silent retreat. Take them for a weekend and ask them to be silent. Go someplace beautiful. You know, it's always good to be surrounded by nature and experience creation. But then, you know, just quiet down a little bit and listen to what's going on within. I had a group of such men with me not too long ago. And Nick was just a great guy, headed towards seminary and discerning it. And it was his first silent retreat, and he was excited about it. And he chose a room. He had a nice window, a nice view, and he was just sitting by the window for hours, looking out. There was a little snow on the ground. But the sun was out, and the trees were there. And you know, he told me later how much he was enjoying pondering creation, just looking out the window. And then he said, on day two of the retreat, a little sparrow came and landed on the windowsill and was just pecking and looking for scraps of food. And he was watching the sparrow kind of hop along. That is, until a hawk came down and scooped it up and left just a couple of feathers where the sparrow was. And Nick was like, oh, horrified. The sparrow was gone in an instant. And he came down to lunch that day, and he looked like he had seen a ghost. But we don't let them talk even during meals. So the whole time, Nick was just like this, just eating his cheeseburger. He told us when the retreat ended what had happened. But silent meals are a part of a hermitage experience or a desert experience. I mean, you never know what's going to happen. You never know what to expect. The next year, Nick took a room with a less interesting view. He was like, I'm done with that. But On those retreats, I have seen men and women encounter the Lord like never before because they try silence. Now, silence isn't just supposed to be a discipline. You know, you're not just proving that you can do it. It's refraining from any outward conversation so that you can turn to the conversation within. That's what's really happening. The Lord is inside of us. The Lord is always speaking, always sharing his love with us. We're just not listening. So that's a different way to think of silence and how I try to introduce the young people to it. I'm not saying just be quiet, but listen within. So silent meals are important so that they can take a bite of their food and say, thank you. And then take another bite and say, thank you again. You know, reflect and just ponder on the fact that God is feeding me once again. He doesn't have to do that. But I've never missed a meal yet. The Lord has taken care of me. Sometimes eating a meal in silent prayer can be really good for our souls because we just give the glory to God. Or you even start to taste more flavors, I notice, when you're in silence. You start to taste the nuances of the food that normally I just throw down my gullet, you know, as soon as I can and run to the next thing. But you slow down to taste. We encourage the men to walk slower on a retreat, a silent retreat, to look at things. Like, don't just run by that tree, but stop and appreciate the beauty that God has given us in each tree. So recollected silence. Bonaventure will take chapter 4 to talk about Our Lady, the Blessed Virgin, and she, of course, is the model for everything, but she's also the model for silence. We have scripture that tells us that she pondered the things of God in her heart, right? That's what allowed her to be ready for the Annunciation and whatever else would come her way. She was a woman recollected, who pondered the things of God in her heart, took silent time. And so when she goes to visit Elizabeth, right, and Elizabeth tries to praise her, who am I that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Mary doesn't fall for that trap of praise and say, yes, I am pretty wonderful. Who are you that I should visit you? She instead redirects the praise to God with the Magnificat. So instead, if you think of what she's really doing, she's taking Elizabeth and inviting her into the song that's already going on in her heart. Mary's already praising God in her heart, and she just says it out loud. God has looked with favor on his lowly servant. He has done great things. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has filled the hungry with good things. He's remembered his promise of mercy. So I think Our Lady becomes a beautiful model for us of what to do if someone praises us, you know. Take the praise and let it go right through you to God, to whom all praise really belongs ultimately. That's a woman recollected, a woman who's silently praising God all day anyway and just invites her cousin to join her in that. The fifth and the sixth chapters and steps that Bonaventure proposes, I'm going to take together because step number 5 is prayer from the heart. And then step number 6, he unpacks that a little more and calls us to meditate on the Passion of Christ. So that's where all this is going, right? So self-knowledge and humility and poverty and silence, they're all kind of dispositions that get our hearts in the right place to listen, and now it's all about prayer. This is where Bonaventure wants us to move. Of course, again, the poor ladies live to pray and to commune with the Lord. So he's even going to affirm them in these chapters. Prayer and the Passion. Meditating on the Passion of the Lord. The saints will say that's the way to holiness. You want to get holy? Sit before a crucifix and look at it and ponder it. And then consider who is really on that cross. Consider how the one who had everything, all the power in the universe and beyond, allows himself to be stripped, to be torn apart, to be embarrassed, spit on and mocked, his flesh ripped from his body, his blood pouring out profusely. Sit there for a little while, and the Lord will move your heart. It's what Bonaventure promises and what the poor ladies live on a daily basis. Sit with the passion. Be with Jesus in his suffering. If any of you have been with another person in their suffering, right? You know, a loved one, maybe someone's sick and in the hospital, and you go by their hospital bed and you hold their hand, or someone maybe is dying and you're called to be there at their final moments. You know that it doesn't feel good to be there, but your heart pulls you there. You can't be anywhere else. When it's real love, that's where love is. Love goes by the bedside of the dying person, because that's what love has to be. It's what Mary shows us at the foot of the cross. If you love someone, you're there when they are nailed to a cross. You don't want to be there. Of course, Our Lady in her humanity would have probably wanted to just turn away and run away, but she can't do that. She's transfixed by love to stay at the foot of the cross. And what happens at the foot of the cross, we know, right? Her heart is torn open in compassion, like Simeon had predicted. The sword will pierce your heart, right? But what happens is Mary's heart becomes so torn open that it becomes the heart for all of us, as he also predicted, so that the thoughts of many would be laid bare. Somehow Mary's compassionate suffering for the Lord made her the mother of all the living, tore open her heart to a place where she can handle any of our pain. She becomes our mother at the foot of the cross, given specifically by Jesus. Bonaventure has some things to say about shame, which is very interesting. I've read some 21st century books, spiritual authors talk about shame, and yet this guy's writing in the 13th century about the shame that Jesus endured for us. And I find it really fascinating. You know, a modern definition, they would say that, you know, we can feel guilt over something we've done, but we feel shame for who we are in ourselves, or who we mistakenly think we are in ourselves. I find that fascinating, that many of us can walk through this world ashamed of who we are, thinking things like, if anyone ever knew my truest self, they'd run from me. I'm not lovable. I'm dirt. I'm garbage, right? We carry shame with us that the Lord wants to free us of, and going to the cross is the way to be freed of it. It's fascinating. It's counterintuitive. Probably don't think that Jesus' pain is going to free us of our own pain, but it does. Bonaventure says, if the all-good Lord himself endured the horrible embarrassment and shame heaped upon him by his enemies, then we too can hope that we are still good at our core, despite the shame we may suffer in this world. I invite you to pray with that. I'm sorry I'm only touching on it for a minute or two here, but I do invite you to pray with it. Jesus died, he was stripped naked and embarrassed and between two criminals. He took on shame so that we might realize that if the all-good Lord is still good, even taking on that garbage, that we might still be good, no matter what life heaps our way, no matter what mistakes we make that we are ashamed of. It doesn't negate the fact that we are loved and good and still beautiful in the eyes of God. That's a mystery that's worth pondering, how the Lord's shame might heal us of shame in our own lives. In the seventh chapter, we get to the climax of the letter, even though there's eight chapters, but this one is on the perfect love of God. So Bonaventure has taken us on a heart-wrenching journey, you know, from awareness of ourselves and a call to humility and poverty, and now to the prayer that we encounter Jesus in our prayer, and even Jesus torn apart on the cross. And now he says, now we're ready. Now we're ready for perfect love. Perfect love of God comes when he moves us to want to love others. I always think back to my ordination 25 years ago was the greatest weekend of my life. And in the book I tell you some more detailed stories of it because it was such a grace-filled weekend. But one of the things, when the priest lies prostrate on the ground, it's a very powerful moment that we're calling on all the angels and saints to pray for him. And the church is praying for him. So you get the church militant and the church triumphant praying for him. And he's lying on the ground in a gesture of humility and trying just to die. The man is dying so that the priest can be raised up. And I didn't know what was going to happen to me at that moment. And friends had said, what are you going to pray for at that moment? I had no plan. But when I was lying on the ground, I felt the Holy Spirit put the word everything into my heart. Just pray everything. Just take it all, Lord. I give you everything. My past, my present, my future, my worries, my joys, my fears. Everything, Lord. Just take everything. And what was interesting, it was a local newspaper that covered my ordination. And the next day, they ran an article in it, and the title of the article said, "He Belongs to God," which, of course, I cut out and saved, and look at that phrase as the theme of my life, right? But the priest does that publicly. We're all called to that. We're all called to give God everything and see ourselves as belonging to God. That's what Bonaventure will reflect on. Perfect love of God. Loving God with your heart, your mind, your soul, your strength. Seeing yourself as God's, apostrophe S. God's possession. God's treasure. That's who we are. And if that's our self-definition, boy, we're going to have joy in this life as we go through life, just knowing I'm only here to do what God needs me to do. No more, no less. Don't have to make a great name for myself. Don't have to show everybody how wonderful I am. When my gifts are called forward, I use them. When they're not, I give them to God. You know, imagine how free we'd be if we really believed that we just belong to God and we gave him everything. I still struggle with that quite a bit, but I certainly see it as the goal of life, to belong to God more fully. The final eighth chapter is on final perseverance. So as I said, Bonaventure does a lot of leading us up to love. And then the last chapter is, well, now stick with everything you learned, you know, because it's no good to do these things for, you know, a couple of years. We got to persevere to the end. And of course, he's preaching to the choir. He had some wonderful poor ladies that had given their lives to the Lord. But he also tries to direct their attention to heaven in this chapter. Why should we persevere in all this? It could be very difficult. Well, because heaven is amazing. And it's beyond what we can imagine in this life. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard. As St. Paul said, the wonders, the beauty that God has prepared for us. Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I want you there to be with me and my Father and my Holy Spirit. It's the Lord's desire. He went to the cross to open up the gates of heaven, not to close them. And I love Bonaventure because I've read a bunch of his things over the years, and he almost never misses a chance to get us there. Let's think about heaven a little bit, because life is hard, okay? So I'm gonna read to you some of just kind of his last thoughts for the poor ladies. And he's basically telling them, what do you enjoy on the earth? Because you're going to find it in heaven, times a million, I suppose. He says, there in heaven, you'll find what you love. What do you desire? What do you love? If beauty delights you, know that the just will radiate most beautifully like the sun. If a long and healthy life pleases you, understand that the just will live there forever in an eternity of perfect health. If you desire to be fulfilled, that will certainly happen when you are in the fullness of God's glory. Even if you wish to be inebriated, drunk, you will be so, as it were, intoxicated by the abundance present in the house of the Lord. We're going to be silly drunk with all the goodness in heaven. He says, if sweet melodies please you, the song of the choirs of angels ceaselessly praising God will be your delight. If it's friendship you seek, the saints who love God more than themselves and others as much as themselves will be your friends, the communion of saints. If you crave peace, then in heaven you will know the peace that comes when everyone has the same will, the will of God. If honors and riches delight you, know that God will exalt his good and faithful servants who will be showered with many good gifts and honored to be truly called and to truly be sons and daughters of God. Where God is, there his beloved will also be, heirs of God, co-heirs with Christ. So the pattern he presents to us is simple but demanding: true self-knowledge, sincere humility, perfect poverty, recollected silence, prayer from the heart, remembering the passion of Christ, perfect love of God, and final perseverance. It is so worth it. It gives meaning to our lives to pursue and to live in the perfect love of God. Thank you.